this whole initiative, I mentioned that we're doing this whole video production, this whole video documentary throughout the process, which this video is going to be part of. We're also writing a book. There's a whole series, you know, that's being written, you know, with these concepts being all laid out as a part of this journey. What's super exciting is with the first book that I wrote in this Ignite Happiness, the fact that it became an international bestseller with all these women from around the world is because I write really well. I mean, I do this one of my gifts. I'd be happy to say my first draft is actually pretty good normally, but I wrote very academically, right? It was just, here are the facts. Here's what you need to know. Here's the lessons learned. Here's how to do it. But I didn't necessarily put my feeling in it. I didn't go there, right? I didn't allow myself to feel. It was actually in writing in this story that I realized the depth of how important it is to write about your feeling, to tell your story fully. Like Brené Brown says, right? Stories you own, you get to write the ending. And stories you don't own us. So I own that story. That is my story to own, and it is my story to write the ending to, which is what I'm doing right now. I'm basically writing a new ending. But until I did that writing and did that work and went through that process, I wrote my own solo book. And I decided to condense it and put it into a story in a compilation book because, first of all, the women were amazing. The men were there. The whole group was amazing. But I didn't know how to write and really connect with people, kind of connect. And we have to change hearts and minds. Nobody wants the facts. They want to know, what do you feel? Who are you? So the book, the title of this whole initiative is called How to Become Visible. And that, to me, I think about my personal experience with inequities and exclusion. I think about living in Florida when Trayvon Martin was murdered and my two best friends live less than 5 minutes away from him, where that incident occurred. I think about how we went through that whole process and marched lovingly, peacefully, and the outcome was tragic. Peacefully marched. We peacefully protested. His parents were amazing. With those things, time after time after time, what that tells a whole country, it's a whole generation of Black children. You don't matter. Mm-hmm. You don't matter. You're invisible to us.
And you fight that internalization your whole life.
I wasn't raised thinking that. I don't think I'd be fighting like I'm fighting right now, because I'm like, I just know it's wrong, and I don't understand why. I'm confused. I started this whole initiative with confusion. You're good people, but you're doing horrible things. How could those two things exist? They basically short-circuited my brain eventually. Eventually, I just could not survive. I couldn't thrive. I literally had I was short-circuited. Like, I had to believe that they were good people. They were doing horrible things. Did I tell you, I had interns come to me about to commit suicide from Microsoft, saying, "Miss Tracy, why do they do this to us?" At one point, I was like, because they can, you know. But as opposed to going home in shame, let me call your mom and let her know that you're fighting a system that exists. There is a system in place where you are not allowed to be successful, even if you've done everything right. Some people will be successful. Some people will be chewed up and turned out, and that is what happened to you. So please let me call your mom. So there's no shame in what happened to you. You know how many mamas I had to call? There's an intern. But when someone's like wanting to commit suicide, bubbling, boohoo crying because they first one in their family to go to college, first one to, you know, excel in college, get a job at Microsoft, right? Or any of these companies. Microsoft is no different. I think they're probably even better at prepared to be, you know, I think with Satya at the helm and somebody else forcing our leader of diversity to do something different and think outside of the box, I think having her on this journey with us would be huge for them. Be willing to think outside of the box and do something different, I think they're going to be amazing. I think the reason I'm talking about them is I'm trying to, you know, the law of attraction, the secret, you know, I'm bringing them into this existence, because that's going to be my celebration. Internationally best-selling book, all these multiple books that are coming out, my true win, and whether it happens or not, I'm already happy. Like I'm an Ignite Happiness coach. But that would be the ultimate to me, and seeing that an organization as big as Microsoft that proclaims their quest for equity and inclusion could actually be willing to do the right thing, think outside the box, and be willing to create a safe space for everyone to thrive. That's the quote from their own diversity statement. So my question to you is, as it relates to this concept of becoming visible, that was your word. As a white woman, you talk about this position of privilege. How would you help another white person, non-black person,
right,
rationalize what's happened historically without feeling guilt or shame? Because this isn't about that at
right.
all.
Right. Well, that's what I'm saying. It was the culture I grew up in, right? So there's no shame from me in that, right? I didn't choose it. I couldn't stop it if I wanted to. It's something that happens to you. It was like learning how to use a knife and fork in the US. Kids learn how to do that. They didn't ask to. They didn't have any choice in the matter. It's just the culture teaches you things.
And what did it teach you about being white in America?
And so as a white person, when I finally got that, that racism, the term racism has multiple definitions, right? And the one that a lot of white people use is the racism of the KKK, the violent, right, unapologetic, in your face proponents of white supremacy, right? And a lot of white people can pretty easily deny they're not
right.
Right. But it has other meanings, right? So then there's the racism of systems, a racist culture, a racist system, a racist organization, right? And that all has to do with different outcomes depending upon the color of your skin, right? And nothing else. So if the color of your skin can pretty accurately determine the outcome, predict what the outcome is going to be, it's pretty clear that's a racist system, right? Again, white people can be like, okay, I can get that. Then there's the hard one, like I said, the internal, biases and definitions, this often unconscious, racial superiority that white people were brought up with in the country. I mean, we were spoon-fed that. I remember giving my boss, who's, like I said, a brilliant black man with a very different background than I ever had, and I gave him Waking Up White to read. And he kind of looked at me like, really? And I said, no, you want to read this. And I wanted him to read it because I had been trying to express to him, like, one of the primary things that I got out of that book is that you cannot underestimate how clueless white people are.
Okay, your assignment on 9/9 is to bring that book and give us some summary of what you're talking about. That's what I'm saying. I had to assume that they didn't know any better.
Well, and the thing is, it's not necessarily white people's fault.
Right.
It's because the system, the culture that we were brought up in, hides things. It can only perpetuate itself if it keeps white people clueless to the evil that they're perpetuating.
Say that again, Karen. Say that again.
The system itself is set up.
The system of what? The system in general.
Our culture, our racist culture, our white supremacist culture is set up to keep the evil of white supremacy hidden from white people so that it can self-perpetuate. So to come up against some of this stuff, when you do even just some basic research, I mean, you don't have to go far to find phenomenal books on this stuff, it's a paradigm shift within you. And so what I would say to white people who are beginning that journey is to take a lot of deep breaths, start with something easy. You know, there are a lot of wonderful books that are spoken with love and compassion.
Name two, Karen. You're a white woman named Karen, and you're asking people to do some easy reading. So give us a couple.
Do some easy reading. Start out.
Do you have any suggestions?
It is a long voyage. It's going to be hard. You're going to learn things about your history, about the history of the United States, about like I said, these organizations and systems that you have that you were brought up to revere, and you're going to see a side to them that's ugly. And it's hard and painful to see those things for the first time. And I would just say, stay with it. Put it down if you have to for a short time. You know, call a friend, whatever you got to do. Just go back and go back. And there's some really, really easy things I'd say. I'd suggest if you're a Facebook user, there are excellent sites, you know, and from lots of different perspectives around the world. And start reading little excerpts. You know, sign up for Medium. You know about Medium, where they post all kinds of articles from lots of different perspectives from all over the world. Sign up, check off race. You want to learn a little bit about race. They'll send five-minute articles to you, you know, 3 minutes, 2 minutes that takes to read. They'll send five a day to your inbox. Just start reading them. Perspectives from different people, people who have very different lives than you do, people who have different experiences than you do, who see the same situation very, very differently because of everything that they know that you don't, because your view is partial, right? So that's an easy way to learn and to grow. I mean, you're doing it at home. You're sitting down in your bed before night. Oh, I'm going to read an article from about, you know, I wonder what the Native American perspective is on this. Huh? Look it up. There's 12 sites you can pick. You know, I mean, we've got the world at our fingertips now.
Oh, I love you. I love you so much. White Karen, my friend, Karen Duvall. I'm only calling you White Karen because you called yourself White Karen, but yeah. I love that. You said your daughter said that first?
Yeah, yeah. She said, you're literally a middle-aged white woman named Karen.
You kind of got it. And Tracy's your friend, and she's doing some great work. You kind of got to show up.
Thanks, Mom. You kind of got to do it. Okay.
And what I love about you is you, as woke as you are, for you to share with me, I'm trying to see. I was trying to find your text. Like you weren't ready. As woke as you are, you think you're not ready? How is that possible? What hope does a white woman have who really hasn't done any of this work?
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm still a learner. I'm still growing. I'm still learning. I still find things within me that embarrass me and things
Karen,
that I,
to, I just like, want you to know. I just find that.
Boy, did I blow that one. You know, I mean, it's...